just so I could kick the show off for me. All right, we're back with round two with Ted Bonds. All right.
Okay. I love that song, dude. It's a fucking great song.
That is a good song.
Great ass album, great song.
Brings back some memories. But am I allowed to say, actually, I didn't write that song, so I'm going to say it's good.
I don't care if you wrote it, but I give props to the guys who did write it. But the way your voice just immediately, like, you know, just when your voice comes in, it's awesome as well. Like, it starts out great, but your voice gives it that, like, subtle dynamic that it needed. And it's like, you got a great voice, man. You know, it's you're a part of the band just as much as anybody that's writing songs on that record. So
awesome. You know, thank you. I mean, I wrote like a good portion, but I think it was actually pretty evenly split. There were 12 songs, and it was like me, I wrote 4, Andy wrote 4, and Adam wrote 4 on Homecoming.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
Yeah.
That's, which ones did you write?
I wrote Insult to Injury.
Awesome.
I wrote the lyrics to Going Blind.
Which is a great, I like figured out how to play that randomly, just like doing it. But those are good lyrics.
Actually, I don't know. I'd have to look at it. I wrote Lonely Girl. I wrote Potential. What are the songs? I can't remember what songs
are. Hey, this is, I have those problems when I write.
You got the list?
Any songs. I got the list. Do you guys get kickbacks from iTunes or any of those things? Like, you get money for that?
Yeah, well, yes. If you buy Insidious Lie, that money goes straight to us.
Good. All right.
And also the early years album that we put out.
Okay.
The Tooth and Nail stuff. I think actually there's like a check sitting out there somewhere for us, but we need to. Because Tooth and Nail sold their whole catalog to Capitol Records.
Really?
Yeah.
What?
So we need to figure our shit out and.
Interesting.
And talk to Capitol Records because apparently they have some money for us.
Okay.
I don't know how much it is. I wish I knew, because, you know, if it's $10, who cares? But if it's,
give me my $10, dude, for sure.
If it's a couple $1,000, then that's worth figuring it out. Yeah,
that's enough to do something else and just to have, you know.
Yeah, I would take. I need some money.
Yeah, we all need some money. That's for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, we got In Memory. Nobody. Who Am I? That's a great song. Was that by Andy?
That was Adam.
Actually. Adam.
Yeah.
That's a great song. My Annie.
That was Adam.
Potential was good that you wrote. That's like the last song.
Yeah.
That's a great song. Sorry.
Sorry's Andy.
Dear Charlotte.
That's me.
That's you? That's a great song.
Yeah.
And then, yeah.
I feel like that's it, though. I think Insult to Injury, Dear Charlotte, Potential, and Lonely Girl, I think, were the 4.
All right. Those are all great songs. I mean, the whole album's great. Like I said, there's not a fucking bad song on the record, but those songs are well written. The lyrics, the vocals are great.
I remember when we first put that album out, I thought it sounded so much like Lagwagon that I had a big problem with it. Like,
you think your voice or the whole thing in general?
Just the whole thing in general. And we did kind of follow, like, what we thought was the Lagwagon rule book of songwriting. But when I listen to it now, I'm like, no.
It stands on its own.
Yeah, it's not. I mean, like, definitely, obviously, Lagwagon was a huge influence, but
yeah,
there's a lot of other influences in there, too.
Yeah, there's, I can hear a bunch of things that, you know, maybe not specifically band wise, but I mean punk band wise, like Feeling It Out.
Yeah. Bad Religion.
Yeah, there's, you know, there's a Descendants feel. There's a, yeah, you know, there's a lot of love and, you know, songwriting about, you know, girls and,
yeah,
you know, that kind of stuff. And
yeah, and it's such a positive record for the most part.
It is. Except for the,
well, Dear Charlotte's a little bit down. Insult to Injury is angry.
In Memory is a little, sad song. It's a sad song.
It's a sad song, but it's a but celebration it's a of someone's life. It's
right, dramatic. which is great too. Yeah. But on a down, you know, whatever, kind of down note, but not much. It's still fucking, you know,
positive. I mean, there's nothing wrong with not being positive or with being angry or sad. And I think punk's a great place to express anger or sadness. But I do feel actually that what we did well was kind of still be punk, but be positive.
Mm-hmm. I thought so. I mean, I would, from that whole record, I didn't think anything negative about it, or it gave me a negative feeling. Like even like some, if you listen to some Joey Cape stuff, it's a little bit more down.
Yeah, Joey Cape, a lot of his stuff is kind of depressing.
It's very depressing.
And understandably so. I mean, you know, you think about stuff like Derek dying.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a, you know, there's a, yeah, Tony, like, and there's, yeah, you know, Tony, there's, yeah, a lot.
Yeah.
He's been through a lot of shit too. I'm guessing that, you know, well, even when the band was writing the songs like Choke, it's like, you know, it's kind of like in a negative.
Yeah.
You know, it's, but very expressed very well. It's like, you know, it's not a super downer, but it kind of is in a sense.
I think Lagwagon has always been kind of, I mean, I can't think of a single record of theirs that I would say is positive. Like, it's mostly angry punk rock. There's some, like, I mean, are there any positive songs? I don't know.
I'm not sure. I'd have to like detail and comb through like,
yeah,
what I thought, you know, but it's like, I can think of a handful of songs and they're, none of them are very positive, but they're very honest and full of life.
And they're great, yeah.
Yeah, and very thought out, and Joey's lyrics are, you know, it kind of speaks, you know, volumes and random, like, you know, I'm like, damn, these, some of the words that you're using, I don't even fucking know. It's like, that was awesome. You know, it's like, it touched me, and I didn't even know the word.
And then on the other hand, Lost at Sea, I feel like, is kind of a downer of a record. Not a downer, not like it's a bad record, but it's about
which
depressing subject matters. It's about breakups and things going wrong.
And honestly, it's my favorite record from you guys. This is my favorite one. And then even before my shows, when I would, you know, before I went out to sing in my car and I'd be driving, that's the record I put on to warm up to your voice.
That's awesome.
So that's my warm up. Awesome. It was always my warm up. They're like, what are we listening to right now? I'm like, well, first of all, we're doing the first four songs off of Lost at Sea so I can warm up. And then once I'm warmed up, we're going to listen to the rest of the record and then we'll switch to something else, you know, No Effects or something. Just get pumped up for a show.
And one thing I think we did well on both Lost at Sea and Insidious Lie is this a lot of the songs, if you just listen to the melody, you'd be like, oh, that's a happy song.
Yeah.
And if you like listen to the lyrics, you're like, oh, wait, no.
Yeah.
Like the song Thousand Yard Stare, it's totally major, kind of almost happy song. I remember when I first explained to my wife what that was about, she was like, oh, my God, I don't know if I like that song as much anymore.
Right? You're like, all right.
Because it what inspired me was a veteran – from I think one of the Iraq or the Iraq 2, he was from Santa Cruz and he shot himself on West Cliff,
ooh,
in his car. And I read the news story and that kind of inspired me to write that song.
But touchy subject for some people, you know, it's like,
oh yeah, I don't know that I've ever, maybe once or twice, but most veterans that hear that song don't like it.
Yeah,
they don't, you know what I mean? But it's like, come on, you know, like I'm actually representing the cause of your brethren,
right?
Who got screwed over. Like,
yeah,
I know you, like, I think it's kind of part of the culture that you're supposed to like be tough and not be affected by what happened, but post-traumatic stress syndrome is,
yeah,
real.
PTSD. I mean, you really have to, I think issues like that, like mental health and, you know, that could like really need to be worked out. You know, it's keeping all that stuff inside. It's just going to keep the fucking population and everybody that's got a problem like that, just, you know, there's gonna be never any help.
Well, I think the inherent thing is, as a soldier, you're supposed to do what you're told. And it's not your job to question whether it's right or wrong.
Mm-hmm.
But at a certain level, we have a sense of morality. And if we're doing something that's wrong, we know it. And so the fact that they've been commanded to do something that's wrong and then told that they're not allowed to feel guilty or bad about it.
Right.
I think it has a lot to do with those feelings. Of course, I mean, that would make me want to kill myself.
Just enough. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's crazy. Do you always like find influence in multiple places, like even just reading the news and all that to write songs? And are you pulling from everywhere sometimes, or are you just like get inspired?
Yeah.
I feel like it's hard for me now to kind of get inspired to write something. And it's like, maybe I'm just, you know, way off of, you know, not in the right mindset sometimes. But then when I just grab a guitar and I'm like strumming, it's like, I think about certain things. And then that inspires me, but like that's hard for me anymore to find inspiration.
So it's really hard to say. Okay. Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of places that it comes from.
For sure.
I know that this year, after Trump got elected, I was thinking I needed to write a bunch of angry political songs, and that this was going to be great for punk rock. But everybody's so
negative about it anyway.
Well, and everybody's on, you know, online, like spouting their opinion about politics. And everybody has an opinion, and everybody like is willing, gotten to this point where they're willing to like take their stand, and they don't care who they're offending.
Yeah.
And then everybody gets offended, and it turns into a big argument, and everybody's like, I'm over it.
Yeah,
I don't want to do that. So this record, I'm kind of writing some more positive.
Like doing you.
Or not necessarily positive, but I'm writing stuff that's, I don't know. I actually sat down to write some political songs, and I just got tired of it. Like it wasn't
for sure.
By the way, I guess we didn't mention this, but we're recording 5 songs right now.
So you guys are doing another EP?
Yeah, we're doing another EP. We got 2 of them pretty much done.
You guys are doing a Kickstarter, not a Kickstarter, but something similar, right?
We did a crowdfunding. We just did it on our own webpage because there's no reason that we need to pay Kickstarter or any other crowdfunding platform.
Just come to you.
We raised about a little more than $3,000, which was our goal.
Nice.
And so now we're doing it. I'm going back to Hollywood in 2 weeks to record the.
Oh, you guys
are 3 songs.
You guys are doing it in Hollywood.
Yeah, that's where Danny, the producer that we're working with,
okay,
is.
Okay, is that the reason? Just because that guy's there?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and he's a good guy. He gave us a good price, and I honestly just really like his whole approach. He's not too. He doesn't want to overproduce it. He doesn't want it to be all quantized and tuned. He kind of wants, you know, a real capture of what we're doing, but at the same time, he knows what he's doing, and he's in the scene.
Yeah. Are you guys practicing a lot? And
not really. It's because we're all spread out. We got Steven on guitar.
So he's playing guitar with you guys again.
Steven's cool. Playing guitar. I'm playing guitar. We got Juice on drums.
Mm-hmm.
And then obviously Scott on bass.
So he's not drumming anymore at all?
No, he's out of the picture.
He's out. Okay.
Yeah. So the Juice and Steven are both in Southern California.
Yeah. Steven. Yeah. He's always been down there most of the time. Right. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's hard to get together to practice. So basically what we do is we get together, we run through the songs, mostly with Juice, get the drums down, and then
right,
we just kind of build it on top of that.
Okay.
Steven and I work great together. So
yeah, you guys were pretty dynamic when I saw you in the storage space. You guys were just nailing.
Yeah, Steven's great.
Yeah.
Steven's one of my favorite people.
Were the EP, like, Epidemic was like, you guys were doing most of those songs at that time.
Yeah.
Because it was so new. And then you guys were, you know, busting through some Lost at Sea stuff with Epidemic. And it was really good. With his guitar playing, I thought he, like, nailed most of the stuff.
Totally. No, Steven's amazing. He's such a good musician and such a pro. Like,
yeah.
Sometimes he doubts himself, but pretty much everything I throw at him, he does great.
I think as musicians, we all kind of just don't like some shit we do. Just,
right. We all doubt ourselves.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, I know I do it too. Like, I'm like, like, for me, this is going to be the first Craig's Brother recording that I've recorded guitar on. And I was so stoked. Like,
that is cool.
That when I put down the guitar tracks, I'm like, oh my God, I did it.
Right. Because every time you've just sang.
Yeah, but I'm like, that's not that. I mean, I could do it. Why did I doubt myself?
You play guitar. That's what you do, man.
Yeah.
No, fuck that. That's cool. So this is going to be in Hollywood, and you got 5 songs, and you got 2 done now.
Yep.
So you got 3 more to go.
Exactly.
And when do you guys think it'll be done? Just out of, I think it's rough.
I mean, I would give it a good
6-7 months.
6 months, yeah, just maybe to be summer. On the safe side. I want to get like 1 song at least out by, hopefully by the end of January.
Okay.
What I want to do is release them 1 song at a time.
So you're gonna take like months and then finally.
Yeah, so 1 song by the end of the January, and then I'm hoping like 6 weeks after for each additional song.
Okay.
Yeah. We'll see what happens. I'm not committing to that time frame, but
no, it's just a rough estimate of like maybe it could be out, you know, this fucking time or, you know, whatever. Yeah. That's cool. Yeah. Are you guys having a good time recording? Like, are you guys all together or is it like not everybody's there during the recording session? Are you there by yourself sometimes?
We were all there for the first session. For this next session, Scott can't make it because it's like the busy season for his work. For he's sure. actually going to record the bass at home through like an interface. That's the world we live in. He can do that.
Right.
Juice will be there while he's recording drums and he leaves. But for this one, I think really like what we're going to do Juice, and then Juice is going to leave, and it's going to be pretty much me, Steven, and Danny doing the rest of it.
Just clean it up.
Yeah, well, putting down the guitars and the vocals.
And vocals and
which
stuff.
Was kind of how it went with Lost at Sea. Like, Scott and Heath did the rhythm section, and then they flew home, and basically me and Dan just did the rest of it. Dan really did, like, he did all the guitars on Lost at Sea.
Dan did? Yeah. Okay, wow.
Yeah. And then the vocals. But it was kind of cool having, like, just a small little crew working on it. Like, there wasn't a whole lot of...
That's always good. Yeah, super intimate, you know? Yeah. A little bit better of a setting.
Not too many people giving their input.
Exactly. You don't need too many chefs in the kitchen fucking saying shit. Have you guys always recorded in Hollywood or just...
Homecoming was in Hollywood at West Beach Studios, which is no longer there. But West Beach Studios was... pretty much existed because of Epitaph.
Right.
But most of the Epitaph bands recorded there. Back in the day
for sure.
Yeah, it's closed now. Then we did that was Homecoming. We did Lost at Sea in Vancouver, Canada, which was cool. It was a great studio.
Just random people that you knew, or because is Tooth and Nail?
No, Tooth and Nail.
They're up there. Yeah,
hooked us up with this guy Darren Gron, who was originally Bob Rock's assistant.
Okay.
That was great. And then we went back to Hollywood to do Epidemic with this guy, Mike Green. Mike Green was pretty serious. I don't know what he's doing now, but
yeah,
he was pretty successful back at the time. Like,
I feel like there's a lot of those guys that were like really producing some 90s, like sounding like fucking punk rock that was really solid. And then kind of just like, I wonder what they're doing.
Yeah. Mike always seemed to me like he was super duper talented and could do it faster and better than most people. But like, he was like so young, like he was like 20, I don't know, 2 or something, or younger.
Right.
And he always kind of seemed to me like, I could do this and I'll probably grow out of it. You know?
Right. Yeah. That usually happens too.
Yeah. Like, he's super talented, super smart. Who knows what he's doing now, but, that was Epidemic. And then Insidious Lie, actually, we did in Santa Cruz. We had Kyle Black come up. Kyle Black was Mike's assistant. And Kyle Black has done pretty well for himself. He did Newfound Glory.
Okay, yeah.
He's done a bunch of bands. I mean, he worked on, like, Menudo and stuff.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah. Random people, like, you know, good producers and good, like, you know, engineers, they'd, like, work with, like, the craziest fucking people. And you're just like, damn.
Yeah, totally.
You have a diversity of sound, just like hearing. You have a great ear for like, you know, certain things.
Yeah, Kyle Black's great. He's offered to mix on this. We'll see what happens.
Okay.
But yeah.
What about so we haven't talked about the record yet, really, but Insidious Lie, where was that recorded?
That was recorded in Santa Cruz. There's a place that's owned by Joe Clemens, the singer at Fury 66. That's where we did the drums. It's called The Compound. It's in Ben Lomond, like just right down the street from my house, pretty much.
That's cool. Who was the who did all the guitars on that? Was it
That was okay. So there was Andy did a lot of the guitars on Insidious Lie.
Oh, he actually came back and
yeah. Insidious Lie actually happened because Andy came to the band and was like, "I want to make another Craig's Brother record." We're like, "Oh, okay,
interesting."
So okay. So we did it, and that's kind of why I think Insidious Lie sounds a lot more like Homecoming than Lost at Sea.
It had a little bit of the same feel.
Yeah.
Some awesome tracks on that.
Yeah.
One of my favorites being Klamath Falls,
right?
Which I heard, you know, like I said, I downloaded that, you know, that track off the internet, like in 2003 or two or whatever, whenever you were doing the acoustic thing of just putting some stuff out. And then I heard it on Insidious Live. I was like, no way, they really produced it and put it out on the record. And I was like, that was a song. So I never thought I would hear it again.
Right.
That was your song, right?
Yeah.
Was that
Insidious Lie is almost all my songs. I think there's the song Fallen that Andy wrote.
Okay.
I'm trying to think if there's anything else that Andy contributed a lot to a lot of the songs, but yeah, they're pretty much all.
Yeah, so I really related to Klamath Falls in the stuff that you said in the song.
Right. Yeah. The struggle of being on tour.
I felt like it was just say like struggle of being on tour, the struggle with having friends, the struggle with, you know, the everyday life of like, why can't it just, you know, go right for all of us, you know?
Right, right.
So, and what made it be Klamath Falls? What was the tie-in? This is kind of what I'm curious about. Like,
so in 1999, when we were on tour with Ryan Key, the van broke down in Klamath Falls, Oregon.
Okay.
Which is kind of this butthole town. I mean, there's like, nothing wrong with it, but
just like nothing there.
It wasn't where we wanted to be stuck.
Right.
And I think the worst thing about it was like August or something. And Klamath Falls is next to Klamath Lake, which I think is a crater from a volcano or something. But there were these gnats. What do they call them? Midges.
Yeah, yeah. Gnats, you know, midges, yeah.
Yeah, and they were just like clouds of them outside. Like, you couldn't go outside because the gnats were, like, so that bad. Like, these clouds of midgets. Like, you, like, had to, like, close your eyes and close your mouth.
Just, yeah.
And breathe through your nose and hope you didn't inhale them.
Ugh.
So we were stuck in this hotel room for, like, I think it was only, like, a week and a half, but in the song I said 3 weeks. I exaggerated a little.
Yeah, that's all right. That's what happens in songs.
Yeah, but it was just a miserable experience.
But a week and a half is a long time to be stuck in a situation for that long of time.
Yeah, we're basically, we didn't want to leave the hotel room. Like, because at one point, we like tried to buy some weed from some kid. He ripped us off. Like,
damn, all right.
Yeah. It was just bad. Like, we were drinking cheap beer and just hanging out in this hotel room all day with nothing to do except watch TV and wait until our van was fixed.
Yeah, that's a bummer.
Yeah. So it was, you know, whatever.
It happens. I mean, that's the road, right? That's the tour.
Yeah. Oh, and then we started getting all these angry emails from people like, why did you cancel that show? It's like, well, are you going to pay for my van? Like,
yeah, we're not doing it on purpose. Like, this is the shit that happens.
Yeah.
No, that's for sure. Yeah, I was always wondered what the tie-in was, because it's so well written in my mind because it's so real that I think I relate to people just quitting, you know, just flying off the handle, you know, being a fucking complete reckless person, you know, and not, you know, getting the shit that they need. So, you know, it becomes like a fight between everybody, right?
Yeah.
So you got like five, right? Plus probably like the driver, merch guy, or whoever else is on tour with you guys.
Thankfully, we didn't have all those guys. And I feel like maybe even Scott, like, somehow got a ride home or something, or got, like, his wife to buy him, like, a flight or, like, a ticket home or something.
Oh, and he was like, all right, see you guys. And you're like,
yeah. I think it was just three of us that were stuck there. But
oh, man, but still.
But I should probably get going pretty soon.
All right, so let's do live?
Yeah, and okay. If you like Klamath Falls, I think you'll like this song.
All right, let's do it. Let's do it. Let me set the camera for you. I think it'll be... This one...
Also, coincidentally, about the Pacific Northwest. Is that good? Okay, yeah.
Oh, yeah, well, probably.
Okay, this is a song about. Let's see. Well, I remember when I was a kid in Mount St. Helens Blue. It's one of my earliest memories of the news. There was this old guy who refused to leave his property. And he died there.
Okay.
But his name was Harry Truman. And so I wrote this song about him.
I could turn it down too if you in the mic.
Oh, that's cool. Headphones. I just like to have one headphone a little bit off so I can hear it.
Something wicked, something strange. Some side of barometric change.
Fucking good. I like it.
Yeah, I think you'll like the recording.
Yeah. I'm excited already just to hear it. You want to do one more old one?
Let's see.
Yeah, you want to hear an old one?
Okay. How's the reverb? Is that gonna throw you off?
Woo!
You want to do a regular? I was just curious.
I could throw some other reverb on that's lighter.
An old one. Thank you.
Awesome, man.
I don't know if I did. I leave anything out there. I'm like, wait, how do I remember the parts without the drums? That's one of those songs that we played so many times that I don't even remember how it goes, if that makes any sense.
No, totally.
It's all muscle memory.
Yeah, I agree. Awesome, dude. Well, thank you so much.
Yeah, of course. Thanks for having me, Joe.
Yeah, of course, dude. Anytime. I hope to come down and hang and see some shows and
yeah, dude.
Hang out, just whatever.
Yeah, I wish we had band practice I can invite you to.
Yeah, that's cool. Whatever, dude. No worries. Even if it's just us coming down and hang out, I don't care. I go to the beach down there once in a while and fucking just chill out.
Yeah, let's hang out. Let's, sure. You ever play disc golf?
I do, yeah. You
know, once in a while. Play some disc golf.
I'm down. Anytime.
Right on.
Cool. Thanks, brother.
All right, awesome, dude.
All right. Thank
thanks
you
for having me.
Hey, thanks. See you guys.